Good evening. My name is Bill Mayer, and I'm the Executive for Research Services here at the National Archives. And welcome to all of you here in the McGowan Theater and to those of you who are watching us online via YouTube. Tonight, we're very pleased to have with us a number of people responsible for the acclaimed HBO series Boardwalk Empire. Through video clips and our panelists' own stories, we'll go behind the scenes of the television show and find out where history and drama intersect. At the end of the program, we invite you to stay for a book signing. Before we begin our exploration of Prohibition-era Atlantic City, both historical and fictional, I'd like to alert you to a couple of programs coming up here in the McGowan Theater. Next Thursday evening at 7 p.m., legal scholar Akhil Reed Amar and Doug Kendall, president of the Constitutional Accountability Center, will be here to discuss Abraham Lincoln and the Constitution. The program is inspired by Amar's newest book, The Law of the Land, a grand tour of our constitutional republic. On Monday, June 15, we celebrate Magna Carta Day to honor the 800th anniversary of that landmark document for law and government. In the afternoon, we'll have a noon lecture on Magna Carta's legacy, followed by cake, and in the evening, we'll present a discussion on the influence of the Magna Carta on American constitutionalism, moderated by Judge Royce Lamberth, and featuring historians and constitutional scholars. To learn more about these and all of our public programs and exhibits, consult our monthly calendar of events in print or online. You'll find copies in the lobby, along with a sign-up sheet, so you can receive it by regular mail or email. You can also pick up brochures and other National Archives programs and activities. Another way to get involved in the National Archives is to become a member of the National Archives Foundation. The Foundation supports the work of the agency, especially its education and outreach programs. Pick up your application for membership in the lobby or become a member online at archivesfoundation.org. Now, I hope you've had a chance to walk through our new exhibit upstairs, Spirited Republic, Alcohol and American History. If you haven't yet, I urge you to return sometime between now and next January. Spirited Republic examines alcohol's place in American history and society. The documents and artifacts on display illustrate the wide variety of views Americans have held about alcohol and show how government programs and policies have changed over time. A significant portion of the exhibit naturally covers the great experiment to prohibit the production and sale of alcohol in America. You'll see newsreel clips about enforcing prohibition and celebrating its demise, ID cards for federal prohibition agents, temperance posters, and both the 18th and 21st Amendments. Now, our partner for tonight's program is HBO, and we thank them for their support, especially Terence Winter, Boardwalk Empire's creator and executive producer, who will be moderating our panel this evening. Now, it is my pleasure to welcome to the stage Terence Winter, Gretchen Mol, who played Gillian Darmody, Edward McGinty Jr., who portrayed Ward Boss Boyd and was a research advisor for the show, Vincent Piazza, who played Lucky Luciano, Lesley Robson-Foster, visual effects supervisor, and Nelson Johnson, author of the book that inspired the series. Thank you.
We lost my...
Thank you very much. I know I speak for each and every one of us when I say what an honor it is to be here tonight. It really is such a privilege. And Nelson, how do you feel having your book in the same building as the Magna Carta?
It's pretty special.
Not too shabby. So in 2007, HBO gave me a book, the wonderful book Boardwalk Empire, written by Nelson, and said it's basically a history of Atlantic City. Why don't you read it and tell us if you think there's a TV series in there somewhere? So I did read it, and it was fascinating. It was really the history of the city from the time it was a mosquito-infested swamp back in the early part of the 19th century up until the present day. The part that grabbed me was the Prohibition era. There's this guy, Nucky Johnson, who we fictionalized as Nucky Thompson, who was a corrupt politician who ran a city right on the ocean at the time when alcohol became illegal. So overnight, this guy started interacting with gangsters, Lucky Luciano, Arnold Rothstein, people like that, and became extremely popular with those types of people. So the challenge was, okay, how do we recreate this? So when I sat down to write the script, the first thing I wrote was Atlantic City, 1920, Times Square on the ocean, hotels, carnival lights, lighted piers, rides as far as the eye can see. And I stopped typing. And I said, this is pointless. We can't do this. There's no way we can recreate this. It doesn't exist anymore. The actual Atlantic City has virtually no buildings like that at all. So this is going to be a writing exercise. And I was watching HBO, to give them a plug right off the bat, and they had a show, a miniseries called John Adams. And they did a behind-the-scenes segment on the visual effects that they did on the show. And there was a shot of Paul Giamatti riding a horse across an open field. And suddenly behind him appeared Boston circa 1774. And I went, oh my God, they can do this. And then I thought, we can actually make this happen if we get the right team together. And we did get the right team. And we're going to start off with a clip of Lesley Robson-Foster's incredible visual effects work on the show, just to set the stage for what we had to create and how we created it. And then we'll move into other aspects of the series. So let's show clip number 9, please.
Thank you.
I would like a visual effects supervisor for my life to just follow me around and just add hair and take off 20 pounds and make me taller, and it'd just be great. That's really astounding. And again, we truly could not have done the series without that incredible work. If you've seen the series, the first two seasons, our boardwalk was actually a standing set. It was the largest standing set in New York film history since 1915. It was the size of a football field. Built in a parking lot in Greenpoint, Brooklyn. And this thing was so massive. For 2 years, every time I would turn the corner and look up at this thing, I would stop in my tracks thinking, I can't believe we were able to build this, and we did it. And that was it was augmented by visual effects of the buildings, the height of the buildings, the length of the boardwalk, and the entire ocean. Anything you see that has the Atlantic Ocean for the first two seasons is digitally inserted after the fact, which is just really, really incredible. So, Nelson, it all started with you, so let's start with you. What prompted you to write Boardwalk Empire, the book?
Well, I represented the city planning board during the early years of approval process for most of the casino properties in Atlantic City today. I went into City Hall knowing the place was corrupt, but I didn't have an appreciation for how dysfunctional it was. And once I saw what a mess the place was in terms of inability to get anything done, my instincts were those of a bookworm. I went to the library, and the librarians fed me books. And after about 25 books, I came away with several conclusions. One, nobody had written a full history of the town. All the histories were pieces of the pie, so to speak. Two, no one had dealt with the black experience correctly, or at all. And three, no one had really dealt with corruption, because corruption in old Atlantic City was an organic thing. It was perfectly natural. They had a short season, and in order to be able to make the season work, you had to give the visitor what they wanted. And as I say in the very beginning of the book, I quote my friend, long past now, Murray Fredericks. I was pressing him, and why is this town so corrupt? And his response was, if the people who came to town had wanted Bible readings, we'd have given them that. But no one ever asked for Bible readings. They wanted booze, broads, and gambling. So that's what we gave them.
There you go. And nothing says corruption like the Prohibition era, which was fascinating in that town. And
well,
it was also an incredible gift for a town that was run by people who were already predisposed to corruption, suddenly making alcohol illegal was
what you
an
have
incredible
to appreciate is Prohibition, and I'm going to certainly see the exhibit before I leave this weekend. Prohibition didn't pop out of the ground like a mushroom.
Right.
People had been working at Prohibition for a long time.
Decades.
And part of their early success was Bishop's Laws. Bishop's Laws said you cannot serve booze on Sunday. And Atlantic City's response to that was, what do you mean no booze on Sunday? That's our busiest day of the week. So Atlantic City violated the law for about 20 years, one day a week.
Right.
Intellectually, morally, philosophically, it's no big deal to go from doing something illegal one day a week to doing it 7 days a week.
It's just math.
And that's what made the town so great.
So the opportunity that was Prohibition, a lot of people didn't see it that way, of course. And in Ken Burns' wonderful documentary about the Prohibition era, there's a chapter in the documentary called The Nation of Scofflaws, where basically that law made felons of all of us pretty much overnight. And there were a lot of people, of course, who profited from it and did see the opportunity that it was. And certainly Nucky Johnson, and even more so our fictional Nucky Thompson, was that person. Why don't we show clip number one, please?
Nucky.
Hey, how are you?
How are you, Nucky?
Nice to see you.
Mr. Mayor, friends, fellow members of the City Council. As you know, in less than 2 hours, liquor will be declared illegal by decree of the distinguished gentlemen of our nation's Congress. To those beautiful, ignorant bastards.
So, yeah. Not everybody saw Prohibition as a bad thing. There were obviously people who knew we were going to keep drinking. And, you know, I always said it's as if you made turkey sandwiches illegal tomorrow. You've been eating turkey sandwiches your entire life. You would suddenly, you're not going to look at it like, you don't feel like you're breaking the law. This is something you've been doing anyway. So overnight, it just became an incredibly successful endeavor for people who were predisposed to break the law. There's an incredible confluence of events, too. World War I had just ended. You had thousands, tens of thousands of soldiers returning from the war who were exposed to horrific conditions and were very comfortable with violence, who were out of work and coming back. And there was a period of unemployment and a very bad economy. And now suddenly alcohol was illegal. So you're presented with the idea that if you are willing to carry a gun and drive a truck and take some risks, you can make a fortune pretty much overnight. So you had guys lining up to do this. And guys like the young Lucky Luciano, who was played on our show by Vincent Piazza, were some of the first people online for that stuff. How did you research your early role, the early years of Lucky?
Well, there wasn't much documented about his early years. I had to rely initially on, obviously, what you put on the page, and then there were a lot of biographies of other gangsters where right. They talked about what it was like coming up and who he was coming up. And not too many people thought much of him. Right. In the beginning, but he had a mind where he was able to see a bit around a corner and was able to survive.
You know? Particularly once he teamed up with Meyer Lansky. I mean, that was a pretty unbeatable combination of criminal masterminds.
Yeah, they were little partners in crime. What's interesting is his family immigrated from Sicily to the Lower East Side and not to Mulberry Street because they didn't want their son and their family to grow up in such a Sicilian area.
Right.
So they put him on a very Jewish block, which is how he met Meyer Lansky, Bugsy Siegel, Arnold Rothstein. And it was worse. It was actually a lot worse.
So, but this is the great melting pot, pretty incredible. But there was a point at which Lucky Luciano, as a slightly older man, and Vincent portrays Lucky, we meet Lucky Luciano on the show when he's 20 years old, I think, in roughly in 1920. Yeah. Later on in Lucky Luciano's career, he made a deal or tried to make an offer to Nucky Johnson that he would give him a flat 20% of all alcohol that came in through Atlantic City and went to New York. But it was an exclusive deal. He would be the only one allowed to use the ports of Atlantic City to import alcohol, and Nucky would get 20%, and that would be it. And Nucky actually turned him down, which probably would have made Nucky's life a lot easier and certainly would have made our fictional Nucky's life a lot easier, but it would have been more challenging to do a TV show because he wouldn't have had people trying to kill him every week. So I'm glad he turned that down. But that speaks really to why Atlantic City was such a valuable town during these years, because basically, again, think about it. This is a city right on the ocean, and where is this alcohol coming in? From the Bahamas, from Europe, from everywhere else, right into a friendly port, which would, I guess, lead us into clip number two.
You want. what you want, you don't want what you wanted at all.
That's the whole sort of the chain. That enterprise was incredible. I mean, that was, you know, that was just our, you know, brief example of how it worked in Atlantic City, but this was going on all over the country. I mean, this was a billion-dollar industry that sprung up overnight with thousands of guys and women, and the bootleg industry too became incredibly popular. I mean, people stockpiled liquor when alcohol became illegal, and I think probably by like 1924 that people started running out of the alcohol that they saved, so they would resort to buying from people like Lucky Luciano and his ilk, but then there was the bootleg industry that cropped up, and it was incredibly sophisticated. And Ed McGinty had done a ton of research about the lengths that people would go to fabricate alcohol. And why don't you talk a little about that? I know you did. You certainly provided us with the details of that stuff.
Yeah, I mean, you know, growing up in Atlantic City, my father would tell all these stories about, you know, the boats coming up on the shore and that type of thing. So, you know, it was just incredible to get, like you said, you know, they essentially ran out of alcohol around 1923. They had been stockpiling in restaurants and that type of thing. So there was a license available that you could actually produce alcohol medicinally. Doctors were writing prescriptions. Well, that was a huge industry that came out of that.
It's not, you know, not dissimilar to the medical marijuana situation right now. I mean, alcohol became the prescription for pretty much anything that ailed you. You go to your doctor and you said, I can't sleep, my back hurts, I stubbed my toe. You get a menu of prospective prescriptions for different things. Well, what alcohol might you like? And it was scotch or vodka or whatever your particular thing was. And you'd get a prescription to go and fill that. Which
yeah,
was
so I mean, you know, we touched on that in the show a number of times, but particularly right. with the Harry Daugherty.
Right,
you
know, right.
He was selling these licenses out of the back of
the Attorney General of the United States.
So that was his racket, you know. He was having guys like Lucky come in and buying these licenses to produce medicinally, and I believe even Mr. Mellon had a deal with that was going.
That is very possible. I can either confirm or deny that.
Over Holt. Distillery in Western Pennsylvania.
Yeah, that is right. Yeah, he did have a piece of that. And, you know, again, I mean, thinking, I think a lot of the thinking was one day this law will be repealed, and when that happens, you know, we'll be ready to take advantage of that. The bootleg industry for alcohol was so sophisticated. There were printing shops that existed solely to make fake labels of alcohol. There were bottlers. There were people who would make, and it got so sophisticated, they would fabricate a label of alcohol. They'd basically, I mean, use everything from like wood alcohol, which many people died, of course, and were blinded by. But they would make basically rot gut whiskey, put it in bottles, slap a phony label on it, put it in a crate, take the crate out into the ocean, soak the crate in seawater, let it get filled with seaweed, and then they'd bring that in, and you'd say, well, look, this is right off the boat from England. And people couldn't imagine that anybody would go to such sophisticated lengths to fabricate something, but they did, and they swore they were getting the real thing, and the profit margin was in, you know, 10,000 to one or whatever. It was insane amounts of money were being made.
It was a real big debate in gangland
right.
on how they wanted to sell their liquor, whether they
right.
wanted to be known as pure,
right?
You know, 100% guys, or the ones that cut it and sell
right.
the bootleg stuff.
And Arnold Rothstein was one of those guys who prided himself on the reputation of only selling legitimate alcohol, and you paid a premium for that. But you knew if you were to buy from him and his protege Lucky Luciano, you were getting the real stuff from England. He had made deals with distilleries in Europe and imported the real stuff, and he didn't want to get his hands dirty. I mean, not that they weren't already dirty, dirtier by dealing in that kind of thing. There was a, I think a period of a month in 1924, I think like 20 people were killed in the space of a week. Very similar to the drug business too, where you get there'll be a bad batch of some narcotic that kills people, and people were drinking wood alcohol, and people were blinded or were killed outright, which is pretty incredible.
Yeah, it turns out that also with that was the government was actually poisoning industrial alcohol.
Right.
So even when they would, you know, distill it down, that poison was still in there, and there was a rash of of poisonings. It was terrible.
Yeah. We, Ed, in addition to being our researcher on the show, played ward boss Boyd in the first several seasons, one of Nucky's ward bosses. We, Ed and I met, he's one of the first people I hired on the show. We met in Los Angeles. It was a mutual friend that introduced us. And I said I was doing a show set in Atlantic City. He said, well, you have to meet my friend Ed McGinty, who's a third generation Atlantic City native. So we met for breakfast in L.A., and Ed showed up with a shopping bag full of photographs and books. And he has a photograph, if I'm not mistaken, your grandfather as a bellman at the Ritz-Carlton Hotel where the actual Nucky lived. And I said, you're hired. I said, this is not going to get any better. And it was great. And early on in the process of sitting around in the writer's room, I would look across the table at Ed and I said, you look like you could be out of the 1920s. I said, you could be one of Nucky's guys. And he said, really? I said, yeah, do you want to do this? And Ed had some acting experience. And he said, yeah, sure. So suddenly he was doing double duty. He was a ward boss and a very corrupt ward boss.
Quite frankly, I thought he was kidding. So that was a Friday. He calls me on a Sunday night. He's like, I'm serious. You got to audition tomorrow. Yeah. My face went white. I'm like, oh, so lucky for me, having done the research, I realized there was four ward bosses. So I slipped it in under the wire as the fourth one. But, I mean, it's just been an incredible experience for me because here I am reading these books, you know, looking at these photographs, you know, giving them to the writers and then reading these scripts. And then weeks later, I'm showing up in period outfit in this room of this that I just read about 3 weeks ago, and it was just, I don't think anybody's had that experience, you know, to go from the research to living in the world 3 weeks later.
Well, bringing it to life, with, I mean, it's such an incredible thing for us, too. I mean, and we had so many people to keep us honest. Ed, of course, Lesley doing her research. Nelson, we've called many times over the years to just walk us through various legalities or what was it really like, particularly when we branched our storyline out into the African-American community, which was something that Nelson knew a great deal about and actually has written another wonderful book about, specifically the African-American community. Do you want to talk about that a little bit in Atlantic City?
Yeah. There is a second book called The North Side, African-Americans and the Creation of Atlantic City. And what I understood in my early research was that if you remove the black experience from Atlantic City's history, the town doesn't even come to be. It doesn't exist. It's something different. I don't know what it is. Because 95% of the hotel workforce between 1880 and 1930, and I know my numbers are very safe because I did a lot of works on the census, 95% of the hotel workforce was African American. So, in Boardwalk Empire, I refer to that as the plantation by the sea, and that was that resulted in the second book. But I like the way you use Chalky White, because Chalky was sort of a composite figure, mm-hmm. You know, because he was a little bit involved in politics, he was a lot involved in crime, he was involved in entertainment, and you had people that really did play all those roles during Prohibition in Atlantic City. And so,
for those of you who may not be
how you did that.
Intimately familiar with the show, Chalky White was a fictional character who was essentially Nucky's counterpart in the African American community. Played by Michael Kenneth Williams, was just an incredible actor. And it was, basically, if you were going to control Atlantic City, you needed to have a very strong relationship with that community as well.
And there were about three or four people that were those go-betweens with Nucky, people that ran the numbers, people that helped him serve booze, people that helped with the entertainment business, and people that rounded up the votes.
Right. Gretchen,
Chalky did all those things.
Yeah, absolutely. Your storyline sort of straddled both of those communities a little when things turned bad for Gillian Darmody early on. We met early on was Gretchen, of course, was cast to play Michael Pitt's mom, which is pretty inconceivable. But you know, when, and you know, initially when I would tell people that, they say, "Well, you mean his sister?" I was like, "Well, no, she was very, very young when she had him." And of course, if you see the show, you see the tragic history of this character. How did you go about researching that role? It wasn't something, you know, like Vincent, of course, had a real person to draw from. You had a fictional composite of a lot of different people and, you know, a showgirl of the period. Mm-hmm. So what did you do?
I mean, I knew so little about where we were going, where you wanted
you and
to
me
take
both.
Her. I know. And really, when I auditioned, it was one or two scenes. So
right,
I had no
right.
information except she was a showgirl, and she was this boy's right. mom, and he was. I knew the actor was not that much younger than
right.
I was. So
right.
you know, and then I was told that she was. I could look at Evelyn Nesbitt, who
right.
was sort of an it girl of the period and an artist model who ended up being the mistress of Sanford White.
Right,
and,
right.
But you know, that was, she was in New York City, but she had a really great diary that I was able to read. So I could sort of see, and she was so young. And so I didn't really know that
right.
the Commodore of, you know, played by
right.
Dabney yeah. Coleman, who was incredible, was actually the father,
right.
you know, so that took us on a whole other.
Well, that was what
journey.
One of the fun things about developing the fictional version of Nelson's wonderful book was that we didn't really know either. You know, as it starts to come to life, you have these fictional characters interact with each other, and it's really all starts with what if. Well, who is the father, and well, what if it were the Commodore, who was the most powerful man in town? It's interesting, when I read Nelson's book, there was this real life figure. Coonley, was that his name?
Coonley.
Lewis Coonley.
Lewis Coonley.
And we fictionalized Dabney Coleman's character as Commodore Keisner. And you know, when you hear the Commodore, it sounds like,
well, no,
he
was the Commodore.
He was, but I mean, I figured out how did he get that name, and it
Commodore
turns out he was the head of the yacht club. It sounds like,
he really,
you know, wouldn't you think
Commodore.
Like he'd be like the head of the Navy or something? But no,
yeah.
The guy was like the head of the local yacht club. So it's like, wow, okay. So it really is a city where you can just invent yourself and, you know, just kind of just, you are what you say you are, which I guess is a great lesson for all of us. This is America after all. But talking about, you know, again, how even, you know, back to the idea that this was a kind of a failed experiment going into it. You know, we really, I wanted to take great pains on the show to not trivialize the need for prohibition in the first place. It's very frivolous. You know, you see these depictions of flappers with, you know, flasks in their stockings and guys in raccoon coats, and everybody's having a great time. There was a real need for reform to a certain degree. Obviously, this wasn't the right way to go about it. It didn't work. But there were families who were destitute. If dad was an alcoholic and wasn't able to go to work, there were families who did, there were no government systems in place to take care of these families who didn't have people. So there was a real reason why people wanted change. And it was, you know, unfortunately, again, the way it was gone about was just doomed from the beginning. And people very high up in government felt the same way. Let's see clip number three, please. Andrew Mellon, who we talked about before.
I am ready. Thank you for taking the time to come here today, Secretary Mellon. I assume there is something you wanted to ask me.
Indeed there is.
Could you speak to the committee concerning your views on the state of prohibition at this time?
My views on that subject are well known.
Nonetheless, could you summarize, Mr. Secretary?
Setting aside my own personal view as to the questionable wisdom of pandering to the demands of a minority, I believe I have been quite clear that the cost of effectively policing this act would be somewhere in the amount of $28 million per annum, approximately five times what Congress has seen fit to authorize.
Would you not consider that, sir, throwing good money after bad?
That is a question that would have been better asked before the amendment was voted on in 1919.
May I remind my fellow senators that the focus of these hearings is not enforcement, but prosecution.
In that case, you are speaking to the wrong man.
Oh, we fully intend to call Attorney General Daugherty before this committee. But what we're seeking today is a sense of to what degree the efforts by your bureau may or may not be undermined by the Department of Justice.
You have been presented with tables laying out the number of arrests versus the number of convictions?
Yes, we have it right here.
Then you are free to draw your own conclusions.
I don't see what all this pussyfooting is for. Mr. Mellon, are we talking about gross incompetence inside the Justice Department or widespread corruption?
It is my experience that human nature leaves ample room for both.
Thank you. That was written by Howard Corder, who is one of our incredible writers who unfortunately couldn't be here tonight, but he, Howard just, his really, his words were, they just sung. I mean, he never ceased to amaze me. Just great, great writing. Really, really fun. Did you do any work on that scene, Lesley?
Only taking out smoke alarms and all sorts of stuff like that. We just tried to, you know.
Yeah, I mean, it's even in interiors. I mean, little things, pillars get moved around, people get inserted. I mean, sometimes even, you know, crowd scenes. You do crowd replication.
Pregnancies
are telling you everybody needs a visual effects supervisor. But yeah, it was really pretty astounding how you know, when you even have this is not a verbatim speech by Andrew Mellon, but it's certainly based on things that he. Was not shy about coming out and saying that this was just really absolutely not working. Even in terms of the enforcement of it, it was the courts were just so overrun with people, you know, breaking the law. You know that it got to the point where certain judges wouldn't really give time at all, or just give incredible low fines. Had you been a judge in the Prohibition era, Nelson, where do you think you would have fallen on the spectrum of?
It would have been overwhelming. And had I been a judge in Atlantic County, I probably would have had to do what Nucky told me, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
There was one instance documented where agents of the federal government trying to enforce or trying to arrest people who were bringing in booze were charged by the county prosecutor's office with a crime. And... It gives you an yeah. idea of what things went like locally. They were never convicted of anything, but they didn't bother coming back because Nucky had done such a great job of, let's say, spreading money around and gaining influence that state and federal government really weren't interested in what was happening in Atlantic City. So they just turned a blind eye.
The actual Nucky's political reach extended far beyond Atlantic City, certainly to North New Jersey with Frank Haig, who is the incredibly corrupt mayor of Newark, am I correct?
Jersey City,
I'm sorry. And even he actually had been friends with the actual Harry Daugherty as well. And of course, Nucky controlled everything in Atlantic City, but when he did start to butt heads with our fictional Nucky started to butt heads with Harry Daugherty on the show, he found himself in a little bit of trouble in this very city. And we'll see clip number four and how that turned out.
Docket number US-137-04, United States versus Leon Bradford Wandover, violation of Title II, Section 3 of the Volstead Act.
Ms. Randolph?
Mr. Wendover was caught red-handed, selling 10 cases of rye whiskey to members of Pi Sigma Kappa.
Mr. Davidoff?
Your Honor, my client has no knowledge
yes,
of...
Yes, I want you both up here now. Your client's guilty.
Your Honor, this hearing...
Guilty. The fine is $5. Let's move on.
Sure, yes.
$5? Okay. Is this some sort of joke?
This entire undertaking is sort of a joke, wouldn't you say? Next!
Docket number US-137-05, United States versus Enoch Malachi Thompson, violation of Title II, Section 3 of the Volstead Act.
Step up, please.
Miss Randolph.
One moment, Your Honor. I wasn't aware this defendant was being brought before you tonight. First, let me say that Mr. Thompson enjoys the dubious distinction of being the premier bootlegger in Atlantic City, New Jersey. The people, on a previous occasion, prosecuted Mr. Thompson for solicitation of murder, graft, extortion, and multiple violations of the Volstead Act. We request a fine of $2,000 and a sentence of 1 year in a federal penitentiary.
Jesus Christ.
Your Honor, my client is being charged with possessing one pint of liquor.
$5.
Your Honor, to allow this man to simply...
Miss Randolph, I sympathize with your desire to bring purpose to your life. However, this courtroom is not the place to do it.
Next!
Docket number US-137-06, United States versus Albert Isaac Gold's violation of Title II, Section 3 of the Volstead Act.
Can you break 100?
So, yeah, there you go. Mabel Walker Willebrand, who we fictionalized as our attorney Randolph there, actually went on to work for Harry Daugherty, the Attorney General, and then after Prohibition was repealed, went on to work for the liquor industry. So, you know, that kind of says it all. Nelson, how does the real Nucky line up with our fictional Nucky in terms of his general demeanor?
The single biggest difference probably is the real Nucky was never violent.
He
didn't have to be.
Yeah.
His power was so pervasive in the community that it was in that if you bucked heads with him, you better leave town. And the best story, and it didn't make it into the book because things come to you after you write a book sometimes from people that lived it. An older woman came to me and related a story of a business that her father had owned, which was a dry cleaning business in Ducktown. It was an Italian surname. Ed, maybe you remember the name. And he had banged heads with Nucky. And the next week, people came in, got their clothes, and didn't drop any off. And within a couple weeks' time, there was no customers. And they were frantic. And the mother says to the husband, you've got to go see them. He went, made amends to Nucky, and the customers started coming back. Now that's power.
Yeah, that is power.
It's kind of what
But in terms of Nucky being a wild man, like you portray him with Steve Buscemi, he was worse.
The real Nucky.
Yeah, he was totally undisciplined.
Right.
When it came to his personal life, and he was very unrestrained in terms of interacting with females and throwing money around and holding great parties and that sort of thing. So Steve Buscemi's personal life is sort of played down a little bit compared to the real Nucky.
Wow.
He was said to have his breakfast at 5 p.m. on a daily basis.
Yes.
Well, some people work nights, you know. What are you gonna do? Well, as the series progressed, I mean, we delved into our fictional Nucky's background and some of the details of Nucky's life on our show did mesh with the reality of the actual Nucky, but the big backstory involved Nucky's relationship with Gretchen's character, Gillian, and we got to see in later years how they met when Nucky was a young assistant sheriff and Gretchen was a young orphan girl. We got to hear, as the series progressed as well, from Gillian, Gretchen's character, what that backstory was, and we're going to see that in clip number 5.
The man selling Eskimo pies.
The sun is all I need right now.
Where are you?
My first kiss was under this boardwalk.
Should I be jealous?
He was a freckle-faced boy from Philadelphia on holiday with his parents. I sold him 3 Luckies for a nickel, and he smoked them all before he had the nerve to lean in. We carved our names somewhere under here.
never came back to look?
It was a long time ago.
At least tell me his name, or I'll cross it out and chisel mine in his place.
His name was James.
You're blushing.
Am I?
Maybe it's a son.
We were supposed to meet the night before he left. In our secret spot.
What happened?
The next day was the opening of the sea. It was a silly ceremony for tourists. I pushed my way to the front of the crowd, and I was chosen as one of King Neptune's consorts.
I can just see you doing that.
The sheriff approached me. Thought for sure I'd done something wrong. Didn't know what.
So he took you to jail?
He took me to a man. The most powerful man in the city.
Oh, this is quite the yarn.
Except it's true. The Commodore, they called him. He ravaged me that night. It was 6 weeks before my 13th birthday.
Jillian, I'm sorry. If you'd rather not say anything.
I want you to know. 9 months later, I gave birth. I named the baby James. The last pure thing I could remember. And he and I don't know how I can say it.
I'll just let the words out.
We lived for each other. A child and a child.
Where's he now?
He enlisted, fought in France, very bravely.
Didn't make it back?
He came back. He struggled to find his place. Overdosed on heroin in my bathtub.
That's how you found him?
I think I will take that Eskimo pie after all.
Talking about booze.
Well, that character, more than anyone else on the show, really gives us a complete look at the history of Atlantic City. I mean, as a child growing up there, and then as a woman, I mean, through the course of the different seasons, Jillian, you know, we of course met her as a showgirl, and then she ran a brothel. Things turned dark, obviously, when she had her failed, or when her son's coup attempt against Nucky failed, leading into this season too. So really, Jillian, I mean, ultimately, without giving spoilers away, is the linchpin of the entire series. Jillian's relationship with Nucky, which is, I think, made it even more essential for us to fictionalize that man and give a more fully fleshed out backstory to him. But That's really a beautiful scene, and so it's funny. I mean, I think one of the testaments to your portrayal of that character is so many people came up to me at the end of the series and said, "I can't believe I actually shed tears for that character who I despised for 5 years, and then was absolutely heartbroken for." So good job.
Well, I have to say, when I would get, and this was one of the pleasures of working on the show, was, and being a fictional character, I never knew where you would take her,
right.
And I did get to do a lot of different things, but that it was just getting the pages. It was always so emotional because you didn't know where it was going to go.
Right.
And that was really part of the fun of being in this world that was a very real place and being a person who her history was so enmeshed in that
right.
world, you
right.
know, in the world of the book. And so it was special that she was actually fictional because she was allowed to sort of intermingle with Nucky. I think I only had 5 scenes with him ultimately.
Which is really incredible, because
yeah.
considering especially how, what an integral part of the story you were.
Right.
But they were very impactful, every one of them.
And even the relationship with Lucky Luciano, and
right.
you know, so
sure.
really intermingling with the gangster world. And
right.
then heroin with Eric Larrey. And,
right, sure, yeah, right. That, yeah, the storyline sort
that.
Of led you into the
yeah,
African American
Yeah, so there was always kind
well.
Of these twists and turns.
Yeah, you were, Gillian sort of became our guide through the
some
world
history.
Of Atlantic City.
Some
yeah,
really,
some
yeah.
really interesting so, history. So that scene actually took place on a real beach. That was not a visual effect. At least the ocean was not a visual effect. That was in Rockaway, which is in Queens, New York. But Leslie, you did a tremendous amount of work in there too. Do you
we
want to
did.
Talk
I,
about that?
I don't
that?
Know if you remember the day the sun was out when we shot in your direction and it had gone by the
yes.
afternoon.
Yes.
So we had to replace the sky completely in the other direction.
That's it's pretty amazing.
In the background and everything. Yes.
Do actors live in fear that one day people like Leslie are just going to replace you completely? In this face?
Every
like,
day.
Yeah, exactly.
Day.
It's just pretty.
We don't want that face.
That's right.
Yeah, I mean, well, they are. You're doing certainly aging and making people younger a lot. So all right, well, I guess come back in 100 years and you know you can work with Humphrey Bogart again. Just plug him in. So. But, you know, so as Prohibition started to draw to a close, things, you know, people started to anticipate. I mean, at 13 years in, even before that, I think once the stock market crashed, the need for repeal became very, very clear. There were tons of tax dollars that were not being collected by people who would otherwise be drinking and paying those taxes. And not to mention a nation that really needed a drink. So the rumblings of repeal started into the late 20s, even to the point where a lot of the early proponents of prohibition, you know, a lot of the women's groups that were for prohibition became advocates of repeal because it was crystal clear that this was just not working and it was just an absolute waste. So. People like Nucky started to plan ahead in a pretty big way, even branching out to other countries to sort of figure out what are we going to do when this thing does come to work. Again, not dissimilar to what people have done, you know, with the marijuana laws. I mean, there are, you know, all these clinics popping up all over the place, and obviously, I'm sure this has been going on for decades. People waiting for that to be. Legal again and just sort of getting their business ducks in a row. So why don't we show clip number 6.
My wife was desperate to come.
Oh, shame she couldn't join you, Senator.
How's the Presidente?
That's what this is called. Damn refreshing.
Where do you try the one at Bacardi's? Pour out the...
Añejo.
You'll see what the fuss is about.
Well, it's important to learn the facts on the ground.
What happened with Wilkerson? Anything you can share?
The great engineer has backed himself into a corner. Wilkerson lays it all out in the report. 11 years of Volstead, all they've managed to achieve is... You're as aware as anyone.
Good intentions.
Unenforceable law.
It's all on the house.
$25 billion up in smoke since the crash. 16% unemployment. $900 million a year in liquor taxes and licenses the government isn't getting. You ask me, the whole damn country could use a drink.
Will Hoover advocate repeal?
He rode in with the dries. He'll have to ride out with them.
You think he will?
Will he what, run in 32?
Do you think he'll lose?
This is all just exploratory, understood? Constitutional amendments don't get overturned.
You have friends who believe otherwise. Men like that tend to get what they want. You said it yourself. Good for the country, good for you and me.
He doesn't talk much.
That's what I like about him.
Let's just be clear. Certain issues regarding your past make moving forward tricky.
Not sure what you mean.
Do I have to spell it out? Your hands aren't the cleanest.
I won't lie. I have been arrested and convicted. 1923, I bought a pint of Old Granddad in Union Station in Washington, D.C. I paid a $5 fine, and I spent the night in jail. It's haunted me ever since. Wendell, if America's not about starting over, where's the hope for any of us?
Senator, I hear you're a bit of an expert on foreign trade.
I'm on the Senate subcommittee.
Well, that young lady, she is very interested in the subject. Would you be willing to share some of your experience?
Nothing in real life would ever happen like that. But in our fictional TV series, we had people. But that's, you know, Nucky and certainly Meyer Lansky found their way to Cuba trying to cut deals with the Bacardi Corporation well in advance of Prohibition's repeal, thinking if they could get a distribution agreement in place once it was over, they'd make a fortune. Joseph Kennedy did the same thing in England. He had to deal with, I'm blanking on which company, it was a Scotch.
King's Ransom?
Yeah.
I do believe so. And again, had these deals in place, so once Prohibition was repealed, he was the sole importer of that product, and of course then went on to make a fortune. But, I mean, the whole experiment was just really just the thing that resulted more than anything else was it made millionaires out of criminals pretty much overnight. I mean, by 1933, or 32, when we got to in our show, I guess actually even slightly earlier than that. All right, 31. Really, that's as far back as I'm going. Luciano was really poised to take over everything. I mean, and it basically, again, this was the single event that made organized crime as we know it in this country possible. Up until Prohibition, organized crime was really election rigging.
It was disorganized. Yeah, it was completely thoroughly disorganized. But everyone wanted what Nucky had. They were trying to create a fiefdom where they could do what you had mentioned about a dry cleaners, where they didn't need to use violence. They could just have their own, you know, Disneyland of vice, or whatever it was.
And it made them, it gave them the ability, the financial ability, to then infiltrate legitimate business. I mean, that's how they got, first they got into trucking. Well, it's all the businesses that sort of were stemmed out from the illegal distribution of alcohol. So it was, they got involved in bottling plants, printing companies to print the labels, trucking companies, and then investments in restaurants, places that served alcohol. You know, again, it just continued to branch out to the point where the very same criminals didn't need to be criminals anymore because they were so entrenched in legitimate business that it was almost didn't even make sense anymore.
Yeah, some of them went legit,
right?
Like the Seagrams,
right? And the, you know, the stakes, of course, were so incredibly high. I mean, as you know, the very famous line in Godfather 2, "We're bigger than U.S. Steel." Said by the fictional Meyer Lansky in that movie, was, I think, uttered by the real Lansky in real life about organized crime, and I don't think that was an exaggeration at all. I think that was absolutely true. Mm-hmm. So to actually make that happen and make allow Luciano and Lansky to move ahead, some eggs had to get cracked. What do they say? If you want to make an omelet, you got to crack some eggs. So. Let's see a scene of some eggs getting cracked. let's see. That's clip number 7, please.
She'll give me the word, and we'll end it.
You fix all my trouble, huh?
It's my trouble, too.
And what do you do then, huh? After you fix.
Well, you have to say that. And I've been loyal all this time. I stuck with you, huh? I'm here with you. Stesso angolo.
How you take care of it?
Just leave that to me. What you don't know, you can't get nailed for. Joe, how much more you want to lose?
Un capo, bicho. One boss.
I'm gonna sit here all day.
Where you got to go?
The head. 5 espresso.
I do what you need to.
That was the boss formerly known as Joe Masuria, who was one of the most, well, at that time, the most powerful gangster in the city. And Luciano and his partners got rid of him, and shortly thereafter got rid of his main rival, Salvatore Maranzano. And that was the consolidation of the rise of all of the power for Lucky Luciano at that point.
Yeah. It's a big move, bold.
Yeah, very bold. Yeah, for a young guy, but it all worked out.
Yeah,
it's so funny. I mean, again, it's you know, speaking about what an incredible job you did portraying that character. I had friends visit the set one day, and they were speaking to Vincent for a while he was waiting for a lighting change. And when Vincent walked away, they said, "God, he's really smart." And I said, "Well, what did you think?" They said, "Well, he's so stupid on the show." I said, "Well, yeah, he's acting." And by the way, I don't know how stupid Luciano was anyway, but I mean, the point was they expected you to be a thug.
Right.
And I said, "No, he's actually."
That
he's
happens.
Actually, people think you're actually.
Shows up to Starbucks.
Yeah. Right. Or, yeah.
Espresso.
Well, yeah, I guess it helps to have that. But you had Luciano over the course of history had been kidnapped and beaten up, and what was the eye injury that
he was kidnapped and beaten and left for dead on a Staten Island beach, and apparently he was slashed his face and it cut the eye muscles.
So the one one droopy eye.
Yeah, somehow I don't know medically, but it was some cut,
right?
The laceration that did it. And. And what's interesting is he somehow outgrew it in his older age.
It sort of healed itself?
Or yeah, maybe he practiced, wore an eye patch. I don't know how he
rehabilitated.
But you look at later photos and it went away. But there was a period in time where it was just this very ominous dead eye.
Yeah, if you're going to be a gangster, I guess you got.
It's a
you have
great
to look the part.
Business card, yeah.
Yeah, we did that with special effects makeup.
It was a latex piece.
Right.
Did you have to touch that up at all?
Sometimes, because it was different on different days.
Yeah. See, I wish I would have known that, because I would freak out on the day, because sometimes my eye would start twitching. I'd be like, all right, we got to change it, and then the new piece would come in, and I'm like, now this one's shut. And sometimes it's, but anyway.
Yeah,
the thing that was great about it, having Lesley on the show too, and it saved us an incredible amount of time. This sounds really crazy to talk about, that this is part of our day, this is what we do for a living, but the idea that when somebody would get shot, it would take an enormous amount of time to put squibs, so those are the exploding blood packets on an actor, and they don't have to go off at the right time, and of course the clothes would get drenched with fake blood, and what Lesley could do for us was add all that in later. So you'd have an actor get shot and lay down and you'll see a big pool of blood. Well, that pool of blood is done digitally. So we never had to clean anything up, and the actors didn't have to change their clothes. And you know, you see it on the day, you see a guy, the actor gets shot in front of you and, you know, six times and falls down. And again, I've had people visit and go, well, this doesn't look real. It's not, he's not bleeding. So it was just wait. And you've got situations where people's, half of people's heads are gone. And it's pretty incredible.
Those were my favorites.
Yeah, those were. But very, well, it's in. We had a character, Richard Harrow, who was a World War I veteran who had a horrific facial injury. And this was one of the fascinating things about researching the show. Early on, we had read about an artist, a woman who was a sculptor in, I believe, in New Hampshire, who was using her incredible artistic ability to help wounded and disfigured soldiers who were coming back from World War I. There were an inordinate amount of facial injuries in World War I because it was trench warfare, and guys would poke their heads up from a trench and get shot or blown up. And because of the advances in battlefield medicine, these people who would have normally died of their injuries were surviving. So you had a lot of guys coming home with horrific disfigurements. And this woman got the idea that she could maybe do a trompe l'oeil mask where she could match the uninjured half of the face to allow the person to at least wear something that would allow them to go out in public without feeling ashamed. And she would generally say, all right, well, do you go out during the daytime or nighttime? And then she would match the mask to color your face as best she could. And of course, we had a character in the show who had one of those masks. So the problem for us was every time he took off that mask, it would cost a fortune because Jack Houston in real life, of course, is fully, has a real face. But not after Lesley got through with them. But we would really have to go through this negotiation of how many times can you take off the mask. And you only needed to see it once, and you got the idea. So that was actually pretty helpful. But our final clip is really basically just to show the end result of what Prohibition wrought. It once again involves Vincent. Why don't we roll clip 8?
Thank you all for being here. Mr. Magadino, especially. Come all the way down from upstate. Obviously, our friend from Chicago couldn't make it. We wish him well.
Pay your taxes, fellas.
This table, it's round for a reason. Because nobody sits at the head. There's no boss. There's seven bosses. A commission. Five families in New York, plus Buffalo and Chicago. Nobody gets made unless we all approve. Put it to a vote. Any beefs, wherever you go, New Orleans, Kansas City, St. Louis, they get settled here by us before things get out of hand. Your way of doing things. It's over. The mustache pizza in the ground. Our friends, our partners, the Jews, the Irish, what have you. If it's good for business, it's good for us. There's no point limiting our opportunities. The future is ours, boys.
Here, here.
Well, it did bring cultures together. That's nice.
Yeah. It was a rainbow.
Finally,
a rainbow.
People saw eye to eye on something. So, yeah. I did have an earpiece when I got out here, and it fell out of my ear, and someone was going to remind me of how much time we have. But I see we do have about 20 minutes for questions and answers. If you want to just shout them out, that would be great. Microphones in the aisle. Ask us anything. The if you can't hear, the question is basically for Lesley, what exactly is it that you do, and are you on set, and how do you do what you do?
I was a fine artist at university and started work at the BBC and learned my trade there. And on Boardwalk Empire, I was on set when there was something going on. So I would read the script and sit with the director, and he would decide, you know, how big a bloodbath wanted to be, or what the location was, or where we're going to chop somebody's head off with a bottle, or any of that. And then we'd have to work out what the stages were to do that. So I touched every department. It was so great. I would have to talk to wardrobe and special effects, which is the physical ones, and the lighting people and the grips and everything. It's a lovely job where you really do have to deal with everybody. And then you would have to photograph the talent so that, you know, maybe I'd have to make a three-dimensional version of a head so that we could chop it up with a bottle, whatever. Then I'd speak to the props people and they'd decide to make a rubber bottle. And then we'd work out when we would use the real one versus the rubber one and the rest of it. So the set work was the great part, the juicy part, because you'd be beside all these lovely people. And learning how to do it just comes with, I've been doing it 30 years or so. So it just came with, you know, all the different shows that I've worked on. And then culminating in being a part of the Boardwalk team, which is kind of a dream job, you know.
Thank you. Yes.
Hi, I have an observation to lead into my question. Someone born in South Jersey, spending 5 decades around Atlantic City, even working as an Atlantic City press reporter, it's amazing what you were able to do to take fiction and fact and maybe create a higher truth. Okay. And those of us who watched the show, we watched it as fans. And we would all have our favorite characters, and Terence, you would kill them off. And I'll talk to you after about two specific now. But you're in it, you know, and it's your life. You created it as a credit to you on the stage that you did this marvelous thing. Period of time, period of history, real place. But here's my question to each of you. Your favorite character or character just put you in all, either for acting or whatever. If you had to pick, and I know that's hard, who was it and why?
Well, it has to be a tie between Gillian and Lucky Luciano.
except Gillian and Lucky Luciano,
okay.
And Boss Tweet.
Wow. If anybody wants to jump in, I have to think about this one. It's really...
It's not a fair question.
Yeah, it's really hard.
There's so many great characters.
Manny Orvitz, yes, our fictional butcher was great.
I killed him with a...
Yeah, you did, that's right. Put a meat cleaver... you had him put a meat cleaver
Harrow
in somebody's
in
head,
him.
And then you had his...
Maybe just real quick to make it a little bit easier, yeah. A minor character.
Minor character? Well, Richard Harrow, I think, was really really special because it was very poignant. And, you know, I felt it was a privilege to write about the experience of a soldier and explore that storyline, you know, the whole idea of post-traumatic stress and the war and the horrific nature of war in general, and to see it through that character's eyes. And, you know, it's such an amazing privilege to be able to get to work with such talented actors. Jack Houston was one of the few actors we cast over videotape. I'm dating myself. It was a DVD. He auditioned in London, and the director of his initial episode was Alan Coulter, whose name you'll recognize from Sopranos and Boardwalk Empire. He and I sat in a room. We watched a bunch of actors come in and audition for that role. And at the end of the day, they said, well, we have one guy who put himself on tape in England, and we watched it. And the performance you see Jack Houston give on the show was the performance he did in his audition. We didn't change a thing. And Alan was so excited, he was literally jumping up and down in the room, grabbing me by the arm, going, that's him, that's the guy. And he came in, and then we dressed him up, and that's the performance. And it was just really incredible. And it was really a fun, small story within the bigger show, but it was great to do. It was hard to make that decision to actually end that story. And we wrestled with it, and we actually, I had to be talked into it because it was the right thing to do, but we all loved that character so much, I acquiesced. So.
It's really a testament to the writing and the casting, because you watch the show and everyone's so well cast, it's such interesting faces, and so diverse. I love showing up to the table readings because you get to hear all these sounds, voices, accents.
Well, it's also, too, the challenge, too, is, I mean, if you think about it, physically, we could not have anybody who had any kind of obvious plastic surgery, which takes about half of Los Angeles out of the acting pool. People had to look, even if they were physically fit, they couldn't look overly muscular. You don't see people, I told our casting director I would give her a bonus if she found somebody that had a cauliflower ear or a nose that was kind of really broken, because people don't have that anymore. You wanted these 19th century faces. You wanted people who looked weird. Very often we would have actors who come in who couldn't act at all but had such a great look. We had a guy come in once that we cast on the show. I will not say who it was, but this guy walked in and I said to Howard Corder, if this guy can talk, we're hiring him. And I don't care if he can act at all, I want that face on the show. And it sort of just filled out the world. And it just, you ever meet people and you go, you just look like, you look like you're from another century. That's what we needed. And that was the challenge. So
There was a scene where Meyer Lansky, Anatole Youssef, we played partners on it. We were so excited. We were waiting for the day when we'd have our own goons. That's when we know, like, we made it. Like, so we'd look at all the extras and be like, no, we don't have any goons yet. So finally, the first day, we had goons. Right. There's a guy pacing back and forth, this amazing mug, like, just with a shotgun in the background. So I was like, we have a goon.
Well, it's funny, Jip Rossetti, Bobby Cannavale, who played Jip Rossetti at one point, his gang of goons had to face off against Chalky White and Chalky's gang of goons, and Bobby came to me and said, Chalky's goons are so much cooler than our guys. Because even like when they were in between breaks, Jip Rossetti's goons were talking about, I don't know what it was, they were all part of like some dance troupe or something, and he's like, those are Chalky's guys are like really cool, and like our guys are like talking about some ballet thing they're doing together. I don't want to have any control over that, I'm sorry, we just... what they look like. So, sir.
I'm curious about three characters. One who's obviously real, the Capone.
Yeah.
And that whole storyline, how much reality is that, and how much of that is we're doing a movie about gangsters, we've got to get Al. And Van Allen, the federal agent gone bad, mm-hmm. who was a fantastic character. And then Nucky's brother.
Yes.
How much were they real at all? And
starting with Capone, one of the most flattering things anybody ever said about this show, the author of a very definitive Capone biography said that he felt our depiction of Al Capone was the most accurate depiction of Al he had ever seen. We really took great pains to get that story right, even up until the end of how Capone was brought down. The whole Elliot Ness thing, Elliot Ness had virtually nothing to do with bringing Al Capone down. He was kind of a nuisance to Capone. The real guy was a federal agent who infiltrated Capone's organization and then in concert with the IRS was able to bring Capone down. My rule for that character and every character that was real was, as long as we were true to the spirit of who they were and the major facts of their life, that I could then take some creative license in fictionalizing the day-to-day. So I would never, for example, have Al Capone go to China. He never went to China in real life, but he did go to Atlantic City. And if he went to Atlantic City, I said, okay, he might have known a guy like our fictional Jimmy Darmody, so I can comfortably create that relationship. But the broad strokes of Capone's life and Luciano's life and Lansky and Rothstein were all accurate. It killed us to come back 7 years in the future in the last season and not, because once I realized it was 1931, I knew Arnold Rothstein was dead in 1928. And I wrestled with it. I said, can we bend our rules and keep Rothstein alive? And the answer was no. I just didn't. We were so accurate with everything else, it would just feel like BS if we had him there, and it would broke my heart. Because Michael Stuhlbarg was so great on the show, and then we thought maybe Rothstein's ghost comes back to advise Nucky, and that really kind of felt stupid. And maybe we dream sequence, and we just could never make it work. Van Alden is totally fictional. My wife's mother, my mother-in-law. About four episodes into the series, I was driving to her house in Los Angeles, and I passed the street, and I looked up, and it's Van Alden. And I went, oh, my God, that's where I got that from. And I had no idea. That's the street I turned off to get to her house. So he's just a fictional composite. And Nucky did have a brother who was a sheriff, but that's pretty much where the similarity began and ended. Yes?
I have two very quick questions. The first is, I'm curious as to how long it takes to write a book and create a series like Boardwalk Empire. And my second question is your Rothstein the same as the one in my favorite gangster movie, Casino?
No. Well, I'll do the second question first. That's Ace Rothstein, who is actually based on a guy named Lefty Rosenthal. But they just fictionalized his name. Lefty Rosenthal was worked for the Chicago outfit during that time and ran a casino in Vegas. So they just took the name Rothstein because I guess Lefty didn't want to use his real name. In terms of how long it took to write a book,
The book took a very long time, in part because I had difficulty getting certain people who I knew things to talk to me. And so I had to be patient. I put the book down a couple times at chapter 3, Plantation by the Sea, because I was worried about telling the story too glibly. But I think the hardest part was getting certain people to talk to me, and they finally did, and then I felt comfortable finishing the book. But it spanned more than 10 years. Writing and researching spanned more than 10 years, closer to 15.
Once I read the book, I mean, my mandate was find a TV series. Once I zeroed in on the Prohibition years, of course, you know, one of the things they said to me when I was walking out of the room, they said, oh, by the way, Martin Scorsese is attached to this. And I said, oh, well, yeah, there's definitely a TV series in here. I'm going to find it. And I went over and I said to my wife, they just gave me a TV series. Basically, if I figure this out, they're going to make it because Martin Scorsese is involved. So she said, well, what are you talking to me for? Go figure it out. So I went into the garage and I came back a couple of days later. And I said, it's this guy, this Nucky guy, is the perfect protagonist for a TV series. And I came up with the story and I went and met with Mr. Scorsese. I pitched it to him and that was the one area in the crime canon that he hadn't dealt with yet. And he said, yeah, I'm really interested in that era. So I wrote this. I had to first do research that lasted for months, and Ed was hugely helpful, gave me just, you know, magazines and books and music of the period and just films, everything, just trying to learn. And the show had so many components. There was the Prohibition component, of course, the Atlantic City component, the women's right to vote was just happening in 1920. World War I had happened, pop culture. I had to put myself in the eyes or the head of our 50-year-old protagonist who was born in 1870. So what does a guy born in 1870 think about the world? What were the things he read? How does he speak? It took me months before I felt comfortable typing and saying, yeah, I think this feels like somebody from 1920 to me. And then the research continued and didn't end until the very end. So once I got going, I think the script took me a month probably to write the pilot, and then we moved on from there. So, sir.
How are you?
Hi.
Okay, so I just want to say thank you for making such a great show.
Thank you for watching it.
It's incredible. Every episode, every season, oh my goodness, Jim Rossetti, wonderful villain, everybody. Okay,
thanks.
So what I wanted to ask you, and I know this is about Boardwalk Empire, of course, I wanted to ask you, what should we take from the Sopranos ending and the Boardwalk Empire ending? What should we take from it? Like, you know, when we think about it, what should we take from it?
My original ending for Boardwalk Empire was that a very elderly Nucky walks into a diner and kills Tony Soprano. I called David Chase. I said, we could just kill two birds here and end it. And I couldn't sell it. I would say the Boardwalk Empire ending is a little more conclusive, slightly. The takeaway is, yeah, this is not ambiguous at all. But, you know, David himself said, look, it's all there. You know, I mean, I think the beauty of that ending for me is that it is what you want it to be. And the idea,
Boardwalk Empire is better than justice. It's symmetrical, too. That's what I loved about it.
Yes, thank you. Yeah, I mean, it came back.
Who better?
I'm all about
who better
symmetry.
Than
the, so.
Who better? The killing.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, and he certainly, you can't say he didn't have it coming based on what he did, so. But yeah, I mean, the Sopranos thing for me, I mean, I've always felt like, you know, whether or not Tony was killed that night or not, one day somebody's going to walk out of a bathroom somewhere and that's his legacy. Even going out for ice cream with your family is fraught with, who's that guy? I don't like the looks of this guy. It's just, it'll never end. And that's sort of almost, kind of a living hell. So that's what I took from it. But thank you for your kind words about the show. Yeah.
I also want to say that I love this show. I've seen every episode.
Thank you.
And I have a bit of a loaded question. If you could do it again, is there anything you would change about the series?
No, there really isn't. We did exactly, we told exactly the story we wanted to tell in exactly as much time as it required to tell it. That's the beauty of working for HBO too. They don't, you know, without slamming on any other network, I mean, a lot of times the motivation is a business one. Hey, can you get us, you know, can you do 26 episodes this year instead of 22 because we're in sweeps? Or can you keep the series alive because we're trying to sell it overseas? When we were done telling the story, HBO said, okay, great, we're done. And that's one of the many great things about working for that company is they hire people they respect and they support your artistic vision. And when you're done with it, you're done. And now I'm on to a new show. But yeah, it was a magical experience for me from the beginning to the end in every possible way and in large part to the people on this stage. So wouldn't change
Thank
a
you.
Thing. So, yes.
Hi, Mr. Winter and team. I just want to say as well, I'm a huge fan of the show. It's so exciting to have you guys here. And it's reminding me of when I was watching the show on HBO Go on my iPad, and I would watch the extras every time away from my internet to load, and your face would pop up, and it would tell me about the show.
Oh,
so this
gosh.
Is great because there's no lag time.
It's great. It's even better in freeze frame on internet. Great.
And just hearing from everyone else, it's reminding me how many amazing characters are on this show. I loved Gillian Gretchen. I thought she was such a tremendous character. And as Terence said, really the linchpin, thinking about Van Alden and everything, it just brings back so many great memories. And as well, I'm a huge fan of The Sopranos. And so my question, too, is about the relationship of those two shows. How did your experience working so much on The Sopranos, both as a director and as a writer, inform your experience in making Boardwalk?
Well, I got to learn what I do at the feet of one of the masters of television, David Chase. I also, there was a guy who wasn't too bad at his job either in the room, Matt Weiner. So I got to spend every day.
Also a huge fan of Mad Men.
Yeah, the creator of Mad Men. So Matt, David, and I got to sit in a room for several years together. So. You know, I just learned a lot about taking your time telling a story, really that it's okay to not answer every question, to let your audience think, to challenge your audience to pay attention. This is not a show you can balance your checkbook while watching. You need to actually think about it. I went into this assuming that my audience are intelligent, curious people who know a little bit about history, who can have an attention span that can last for 55 minutes a week, and they're actually going to be engaged by that. So that helped a lot. In terms of the overall organized crime aspect, The Sopranos was basically about the end of something, and this was the very beginning of that something. This was the beginning of organized crime. So for me, it was a real luxury to start from the beginning before these guys were what Tony became, and to really start from ground zero, which was Prohibition.
Well, it's a really great treat to have you all here. Thank you.
Thank you. So I think we have time for one last question. We have one last question. So.
Hi. So my two favorite things about the show was the acting, which was just like, I don't know how you got the most amazing actors out there. But my second thing was all the historical tidbits that kind of got just like weaved into the show, like the mm-hmm. random
yeah.
stories from newspapers that were big at the time, but everyone forgets about. And I'm sure you had to, you know, go back into newspapers and into the book and find these weird stories that people would have known about at the time,
right.
but we don't know about as a modern audience. And I was just wondering for each of you, because all of your research for your roles or for your writing was so different, what was your favorite historical tidbit that, you know, was used in the show or you discovered in your research?
Early in season one, I read about a woman who claimed to be the Grand Duchess Anastasia from the Russian family, and she had surfaced somewhere, and it just struck me as such an interesting little odd thing, and people were fascinated. They thought she was the one surviving Romanov, you know, who was not accounted for in that slaughter, and it captivated the country, and then, of course, it turned out that she wasn't, but I was able to weave that into a storyline where Margaret Nucky's, who ultimately became Nucky's wife, was really fascinated with that story because she lived vicariously through this woman who might actually be a princess and then was kind of heartbroken herself when she realized the woman was a fraud. So it was just a fun little thing. There were dozens of them over the years, but any... guys have any?
We were saying before that nothing was arbitrary in the writing ever. It always felt like you could look something up and it was there for a reason. This isn't a fact. I mean, this was just in the last episode when Gillian has the ladybug on her hand. And so, I don't know, I just thought, there's something more to this. What's the significance of a ladybug? Google. And of course, a ladybug on the hand means good luck. So, I mean, this was just, I mean, this has nothing to do with 1920s. I don't know when that was, but.
Well, I think ladybugs were invented in 1922.
They were. Okay, but a real, okay, and then Dr. Henry Cotton, that was a real man.
Right.
The person that she was, you know, getting the body parts taken out to sort of get the bacteria out. I had no idea about that, and that was
that
not
was something
my favorite
we
thing, but it was
stumbled on in the research, and this is too amazing to believe it actually happened in a hospital in New Jersey. His theory was that illness lay within the body in various organs, and he just accused these patients of this institution as experiments and would just randomly take out teeth, body parts, and things like that. That was the feel-good episode of the year.
Yeah.
The Van Alden self-help stuff.
The Emil Cooey. His Van Alden's doing his daily affirmations every day in every way of getting better and better. Was actually a very popular. And Eli early on had taken the original Dale Carnegie course. It was interesting too. I was very proud. In 1920, Dale Carnegie, the actual Dale Carnegie's name was spelled differently from Andrew Carnegie. But he changed the spelling to match Andrew Carnegie's name later because he felt people would assume they were related and he must be as successful too. So we had printed the Dale Carnegie book for season one and we spelled it the original way as Carnegie would have spelled it in 1920 before he changed his name. And every time people go, oh, you know, you say you pay attention to detail, but you spelled Carnegie wrong. I say, oh yeah? Google it. And pow! So, that's it. Thank you very much. It's really, really fun.